all of us over here know that they pick up compounds or drugs which have to be marketed later on to make a lot of money. In open source, we are not talking about a marketing or money-minting proposition. What we are talking about over here is making drugs for the neglected diseases. So that is our main focus. Now, drug discovery, as we know, is a very labor-intensive, money-intensive proposition. The real innovation, what we say, is the way innovating how we innovate. This is food for thought. Now, how do we bring some kind of innovation into drug discovery? Anybody who has been in the industry, pharma industry, will know what are the rigors which go into discovering the target first, then looking at the inhibitors, like all the in silico work which goes into it, then all the hit to lead to candidate to clinical phase 1, phase 2, phase 3. All these things take a lot of work and effort. My background is basically in the pharma industry. Ryan Baxi, Nicholas Piramal, I worked all over in these places. Even when I worked abroad, I worked into medicinal chemistry and the drug discovery aspects of these molecules, right from vitamin B12 in Cambridge University to Taxol in UK and Canada and US. So I will resist the temptation of going deep into the drug discovery part and just touch up briefly about what we are doing in the OSDD network in CSIR. But if you have any questions, you can contact me later. I'll be happy to answer those as well. I'm sorry. Yeah. So like I was saying, if we do discovery in the same old-fashioned manner, like it has been going on for centuries together in the pharma industry, we'll end up making molecules which are really expensive and which will not cater to the people who really need it, especially in the context of neglected diseases. Why neglected diseases? Because that is the area where pharma industry is not interested. Even if they are taking up some, like malaria or tuberculosis, that is mostly for namesake. Their focus is on cancer, diabetes, which is going to be the next cancer, like the next market to be. So we are thinking of going into only neglected diseases, and that too one by one. We cannot take the onus of taking too many diseases at one time, the drug discovery, development, as well as the diagnostic at the same time. So we have to go step by step. And what we are doing is that exactly that over here. We are saying that, do we have only brilliant minds only in the industry? Do we not have them in the academia? We say our IITs, ICs are so great. So why not tap into that potential? Why only go to the people who think they know everything? Why not go to the people who think in a different, innovative way, manner of thinking? I'm talking about students here and researchers in the beginning of their PhD. They can also think in a different way. They can come up with questions which doesn't actually occur to the pharma people because they are trained to think in a specific manner. This is the molecule. Does it follow Lipinski's rule? No. You should not take it up. Does it have a nitro group? Oh, no, no, don't even touch that molecule. That kind of the molecular weight over 450, you're not going to look into it. Eventually, it's not going to be a drug. That is a thing which is dinned into the minds of people who are there in the pharma industry. But look at a newcomer. They may not know about Lipinski's rule. They may not know about these kind of conventional rules which are existing. So they can ask questions. Why not take this forward? So ultimately, our aim is, does it enter the cell? Does it kill the parasite with more in comparison to the healthy cells? That is what we are looking into, not pulling down drugs in the very initial phase. So we need to tap into all this potential, which we can do in the open source manner. Sorry. So TB was our first focus. Why? Because of the statistics which is given here, that itself tells us world over one person is killed in every 20 seconds by they die because of TB. That is 1.7 million people every year. In India, nearly 1,000 people die every day and 2 people every 3 minutes. Just the statistic itself is very important in order to look into what is the real requirement of the industry, of the country right now. If you look at the TB drugs which are existing right now, look at these drugs. which are usually used in the TB treatment. They are isoniazid, ethambutol, rifampicin, and cycloserine to some extent, kanamycin to some extent. And when were they discovered? 1963 is the last year when any drugs which have been used in the TB drug treatment has been discovered. Imagine the great gap that is there, 47 years. Even if people are claiming that they are working on this particular disease, no drug is coming out. Why? Because the claim aside, their focus is different. The focus is cancer, diabetes, maybe infectious diseases. Now, what is the philosophy of open source? We say that many eyeballs make the buck shallow. So more people are looking into this particular thing. They're looking at the mycobacterium from different angles. So that will give us a lead as to how we can attack this bacterium and how we can actually develop a drug which are not so harmful to the human beings. And they can selectively kill the drug. So if they do this particular, take up this particular TB in an open source manner, we won't have all these questions which come to the scientist's mind. The first question which arises is, oh, will my credit be taken away? How can I publish a paper or patent my invention once it is out in the public? The thing is, you don't have to worry that somebody will take it away because the industries are not so interested in it. And it is a very labor-intensive thing. And once you put anything into this open system, it is not like your credit is going to be taken away. Your credit is going to be stamped over there with time and date. So when you're entering a particular idea there, the time and date goes against your name. So no one else can take this credit away. And we have in front of us several of these open source models which have been extremely successful. I need not go into it because everybody knows about the Human Genome Sequence Initiative, the Linux, Android, and the World Wide Web. So with all these things in mind, CSIR led this Team India Consortium, and it's not just limited to India. Worldwide people are contributing to this particular endeavor. This open source rat discovery model, the SysBOG platform, a wiki portal was created, wherein anybody, you can just log into it, enter your credentials, whatever. You can become a community member. You can put in your ideas, your projects. It will be reviewed by the community itself. And all these people, what we are trying to integrate is the people, the process, and the information. It will be available to everybody. Whether it is posted online by a professor in Yale or Harvard or by a student in Chennai or Kerala or any other part of India, it will be available to all. So what you do is you give your project, that will be reviewed through the various systems, and then this is one example of how it is reviewed. You put in a project, it will be reviewed by another person in the community. Doesn't matter if it is posted by a professor, it can be reviewed by a student, and they can post a comment. Another person can come and then say that this is the demerits and the merits of this particular comment and this particular thing. You can even ask the other community how this can be taken forward. Anyone can say, okay, now we have the facility here in Chennai, we can take it forward. Okay, after compound is synthesized, we don't have the facility to screen this against the mycobacterium tuberculosis. So that can be done in a different place. Maybe Jalma, maybe any other place which is competent to screen that particular compound. So along with this, we are also looking into all, now what we are here, what I'm showing is, the system architecture has gone into such an advanced thing where there is protection of data at the same time openness, at the same time attribution, everything. So it was becoming difficult for just CSIR scientists to handle it. So luckily Infosys has partnered with us, and at a very minimum rate, which can hardly be called any amount, it's just for one technician, whatever we are paying, and they have taken out the whole load on themselves to maintain the whole portal. So it is really tight, at the same time very transparent. I've talked about the attribution so that the credit doesn't go elsewhere. Now the patent, whenever we think of drug discovery, we think of patenting. That is how it has been for all these decades in the West. And we in India, we are relatively new to drug discovery. But that's okay. We are catching on to patenting things. And the previous speaker also mentioned, like, the pharma industries, we cannot take it to phase three and all. Just moving away from this talk. We in India are very new to this game. It's hardly like, when did Ranbaxy start this new drug discovery? I was in Ranbaxy when I joined. Ranbaxy, I was into the generics division. It was because there was no new drug discovery. And we started in one particular room, one small room. Then we made it into a division. We moved to Okla. Then the Okla moved to Ranbaxy too. Similarly, in Piramal also, it is very new. So we are still learning from the West, at least in this particular area. They have been doing drug discovery for the past decade, I mean, not even decade, for the past century. The Pfizers and the Eli Lillys have been there for in the last century. So we will be there. Phase three, it's difficult for us to tackle right now, but we are going forward through CROs, we are gaining the experience. Now we have companies, because of the enormous investment which is required in phase three, maybe just the Indian company right now are not still there, but we will be there soon. The way we are learning, moving forward, and learning from the mistakes that West has made, it will make it easier for us. But coming back to the patent, we have a philosophy of patenting in OSDD, but not the same philosophy which is there for patenting, which is there in the pharmaceutical companies. In the companies, we patent in order to mint money later on. Here we are patenting to ensure that eventually when the drug is out there, that it will be manufactured by companies. The license is with us, and we'll license it to those companies which will agree to market it in a very affordable way. They can make a small profit, but not the huge profit which is generally made in the West. Not in the West, by any pharma companies. The profit will be just for them to sustain themselves. Only to those companies we are willing to license out. That is the reason we are taking license, because our philosophy is affordable healthcare for all. No boundaries. Right now, we are saying all. Maybe some people will say, we are invested so much, we want the market, US market. We might say okay to that, but we will say for the developing countries, Asia, Africa, no boundaries, Pakistan, Bangladesh, India, we'll have the say in the pricing. So that is the reason we are saying we'll have the patent. So we have started the work in OSDD now. Here we are looking into all aspects of drug discovery. We are looking at target-based drug discovery. We are looking at natural product screening. We are looking at ligand waste. So we are looking at in silico thing which is going on right now, bioinformatic in silico. At the same time, we are not restricting ourselves to that. We are screening the large amount of library which is there all over the country, even from the West, if we can get hands on it. So we have facilities to do that. We're doing the screening. We also plan to have biological repository, chemical repository, everything. So we'll have a repository of all kind of strains for TB, all kind of natural products or synthetic molecules which have been made right now for TB. But when we take it into malaria and other things, we can screen the same thing for those two. So there's no restriction. Anybody can contribute to this. And if they have any compound which is made, because there are so many universities across India who are making compounds and keeping in the shelf, they don't have the facility to screen in the university, and they may like to pay to some organization, pay some money to the organization to get a screen. Free of cost, we can do the screening for them. And the data will be posted for everybody to see on the portal. So it's not like only those people can see the data. Anybody can see the data. Anybody can say, this is a promising molecule. We can do further work on this. We can do the analoging. We can do the DMPK, ADME, toxicology, whatever. And we'll look into it, how it can be taken forward. Right now, these are the status of the projects. Like, there are several, these numbers keep changing. So there will be more than 18 now in the drug target identification process, in the virtual screening, number in the chemical synthesis library. There are 9 over here. It could be more, 10, 11, 12. And we are trying to take 2 compounds forward in this particular process. We are still in the early stages, as you see. Looking into the mining the already literature which is available out there we have come out with 1,544 drug targets. Out of this, 119 have been experimentally validated and 1,425 are still predicted. It's not validated. So it is up out there in the portal. Anybody can say, okay, I can take this up and validate the same. So these are more into like drug discovery part. Maybe I should skip it or just go quickly over these. Like KiddoQ is one of the docking based LAG score ligand based drug discovery program. There are several programs of like this and you can buy them at a very enormous cost from companies. But this is something which is out there on the portal. Anybody can use or ask the person concerned how to use it, or just give the structure to the person concerned to dock into this particular program and see what is the drug-like properties. I mean, if there is a particular target, small molecule, where it is binding, how it is binding, which particular sites can be modified to make it more, the binding constant to be more effective, hence the IC50 to come down into nanomolar from micromolar. Similarly, this is another program which is there in the portal. And this is like, we all know that when we intake drug molecules, any drug, it is going to get metabolized. So this is a prediction model, like how it is going to get metabolized. Supposing some drug is going to get metabolized in seconds, it's not worth it because it will never reach the systemic circulation and the target in order to kill the bug and then to be excreted in a manner after doing its work. It should not be excreted quickly. So many other parameters have to be taken into account. So this is one place where the CYP3A4 or the CYP450 enzymes in general can be, it can predict like how fast a metabolism will take place and what is it, which is a particular area where it is going to get metabolized first, so you can modify accordingly and make it more stable. If somebody wants to know more, I can tell about it later. Also, this was one particular program which is undertaken by OSTD, the Connect to Decode program, where the Mycobacterium tuberculosis genome was reannotated, and this was primarily done by students all across India with the help of course mentors, which were their professors and scientists with their help. And this was one project which had enormous impact on the way we can tap into the strength of the student community. Here we can see how the errors were identified by the community, how it was reconfirmed that it was an error, and how it is and then rectified. And all this has been done by the community itself. These are some of the comments. I just posted a couple of comments here, and which other people have looked into it and said that this particular endeavor has packed 300 man-years into 4 months. And that is a real good comment on this particular endeavor, which was taken in an open source forum. Now we have in the pipeline. Actually, when we talk about drug discovery, there are so many meticulous things to be taken care of, because ultimately the drug has to go into the human and we have to follow DCGI or the FDA or whatever norms are there existing. So these things take a long time, but we are taking into account all these things. We are taking into bringing into on board people who have real life experience in drug discovery. I've also come on board because of this kind of background. And now we have got dedicated chemical synthesis lab. We have got labs where we will need BSL-3 facility, biosafety level 3 facility, because this cannot be done on bench. Mycobacterium has to be handled in a very organized manner, in a very safe manner. So we are going into all those things. And sequencing of MTB strains is going on. After looking into TB for the last 2.5 years or so, we are thinking of getting into malaria as well. Since now we have some kind of expertise, we'll take that also side by side. This is just to see, just to show you, yeah, this is almost over. Just to show you like what is it that discovery entails. I'll quickly skip. And this is my last slide. So in the OSTD community right now, we have got 4,511 members all across the world. And they are contributing. Whenever we go to some symposium or something, we request the professors from all over the world just to look into it. Because the students are proposing, other people are acting on it, just to give one comment or two on how it is, what is possible, what is not feasible. Let's not go this through this path. This has been done. This may not be successful, and this is the right way to go. If they give one or two comments, it will help the community. So these are people who are logged into OSGD portal all across the world. So I thank the whole community because of which the work is going forward, because of which I can talk to you with this much strength from OSGD. Thank you.